Hello, this is Richard with Janus Motorcycles, and today I'm going to talk a little bit about our frame. The frame on a motorcycle is the component which keeps everything in line. Last week we talked about the front suspension and how important it is for the wheel to be in line with your handlebars or the way that you can steer the bike. The same thing is true of a frame. What the frame is doing is making sure that the front wheel and the rear wheel are staying in the same axis. They're not moving at all sideways. And that's the same thing that happens with the front end. If the wheel is moving different than your handlebars or having any bending, the same thing is true of the frame. You'll get poor handling or handling which is unpredictable. First days of motorcycling, motorcycle frames were bicycle frames. So they were pure and simple, just like the modern bicycle frame that you're familiar with, like, which we call a diamond frame. That's what a motorcycle frame was. It was just one tube connecting the engine, one tube up to the seat, and one tube across, and then whatever suspension system they were using. And the weakness of that design is that it's strong in one axis, but it's subject to bending, twisting, among other things. So motorcycle design up until the 1930s, even the 40s, was still working with that system, and they were finding the limitations of that with more power coming out of the bikes. So by the 1940s, they were looking for other solutions, and that was also about the same time that the welding was becoming something that was commonly used on motorcycle frames, or was starting to be used at all. Up until that point, just like, again, with bicycles, motorcycle frames were used a lugged connection. So what that means is that you may be familiar with your vintage bike or even modern bicycle. They have a lug, which is a little metal joint, and the tube slides into that joint, and they braze that. And brazing just means it's like a kind of like glue. It's just soldered together, and that's how all motorcycles were built. Up until about around this time, there were exceptions. Welding was being used, but in 1949, a guy named Rex McCandless, who's an Irishman, developed a frame he didn't have a name for it at that point, but it was a double cradle frame. It looked very similar to this, and he pitched it to Norton Motorcycles, which at that time was in its heyday. It was really doing well. The Isle of Man Tourist Trophy was the race to win, and they were winning it. But their frame, what they were using, was essentially a diamond frame like we've been talking about, where it's just one tube, no stiffness. And so that frame had been colloquially named the Garden Gate, because when you rode it, it felt like you were swinging around on a garden gate. It was just kind of a loose connection between the wheels and the engine. They were looking for a better solution, and this frame provided more rigidity. So it did so by using regular bent tube with welded connections. So to really understand the significance of this frame, you have to understand that doing all these joints like this, where they're coming in at different angles, wasn't as easy to do with a lugged frame. And so that's why. It's one of the reasons the motorcycle manufacturers were still sticking with that kind of construction. So with this frame, they were highly successful at the Isle of Man race, which still is an incredible race in England, off the coast of England. And they realized that this was a path they wanted to pursue. And so they brought Rex McCandless, the inventor of this frame, to England and to the frame manufacturer which Norton used, called Reynolds. And Reynolds took his design and started being able to produce it. And during that first TT season at the Isle of Man, one of the Norton Works racers just called this frame. He said, compared to riding the Garden Gate, this is like riding a feather bed. And that's the name of the frame. Ever since then, it's been called the Norton Featherbed, or the Featherbed frame, because it is plush. It used, among other things, a different kind of rear suspension, which I'm going to talk about a little bit in a second. And it was stiff. So it was a rigid connection. There was very consistent handling compared to the bikes of that time frame, and it was a comfortable bike. I mentioned the rear suspension. That's one other part of this frame that's a little different than what was available at the time. Rear suspension was also developing at this point, and unfortunately this bike doesn't have rear suspension. This is our Halcyon model, but the original Featherbed used a pivoted swing arm suspension like we're all familiar with now, but that was kind of a little bit of a different thing from what most bikes were using. They were using plunger suspension or various types of kind of early attempts at rear suspension. So this had rear suspension. So again, that contributed to that Featherbed feel. And eventually it became a road production motorcycle, not just for motorcycle racing. And it went on to become one of the most famous frames throughout history. It was famous for the cafe racers. The Norton frame was so good that people with a Triumph engine, which was the faster engine or the higher performing engine, would drop a Triumph engine in their Norton frame. That was the ultimate cafe racer move, and that was called the Triton, which would be the combination of those two marks into this awesome cafe racer. So anyway, we chose this frame because, like many other manufacturers, including most of the Japanese manufacturers and BMW, they recognize this as a really great way to make a frame, the welded connections as opposed to brazing, and this double cradle frame, which was just so versatile. You can put, it's just a giant space in here, you can put anything you want. So we chose this frame because of it was just a tried and true design that has been used with many different engines and many configurations by many different manufacturers, and also because we knew it worked. It was just a tried and true design. We first used this frame with our Halcyon 50. The Halcyon 50, as you all know, is just like our Halcyon 250, a rigid hardtail bike. So we were kind of modifying the frame, in a sense, going back a little bit with the hardtail frame. But we also have our Phoenix and Griffin models, which use, I mean, if you were to see a Phoenix frame next to a Norton Featherbed frame, they're essentially the same frame. But we started off on the 50cc bikes with this frame, and we used a 7/8 inch tube, so essentially handlebar thickness for all the 50cc's. And we built a number of those and worked out a lot of the kinks with that bike and where the frame needed to be improved. And this, we went up to 1-inch tubing with our 250, and we use a drawn over mandrel tube stock. So that means that it's the really, really high quality. We don't use things like chromoly or more advanced types of steel. We use a mild steel because it's very forgiving. It doesn't require heat treating, and it's very flexible in the sense that over time it's more resistant to stress fatigues. But it is drawn over mandrel, and drawn over mandrel means that it's a completely consistent wall thickness and shape all the way through. It's not been rolled and then welded to form a tube. It's a round shape that's very, very true, which we really wanted on a motorcycle frame that would be subjected to road forces for many years. So we've had a lot of luck with this frame. It's a fantastic bike. As you all know, we've ridden it all over the country. It's now made some very long trips outside of the country. It's really great. We're really happy with it. It's easy to work on. This frame is a classic example of our design mantra here at Janus, which is, using the best of the past to make a great modern motorcycle for the future. So we're really, really, really pleased with this frame, and we can't wait to have more people try it out. Thank you very much.